So welcome to Samvaad 2.0, and we will be again starting with a fresh cycle of Samvaad talk series. And this time we have decided to make it a thematic talk series where every month there will be a dedicated theme and faculty members and guest speakers related to that specific theme will be talking about their research. So I thought that we will be starting with ML and AI because given the importance of ML and AI in the current context, but fortunately or unfortunately, the organizers thought of starting with cryptography and security. So today we will have our first lecture on the thematic talk series on cryptography and security. And it's my privilege to have with us Professor Bhavana, who is currently an assistant professor at Computer Science and Automation Department at Indian Institute of Science. So a little bit about her background. She did her PhD at Boston University, where she got the Research Excellence Award, and she was a postdoctoral researcher at University of California, Los Angeles. So she works on theoretical cryptography and specifically on non-malleable codes. And she has published in almost all the top venues that any computer scientist can think of, such as Journal of the ACM, IEEE Transactions on Information Theory, Eurocrypt, Crypto, STOC. So without wasting too much of time, over to Bhavana. Thank you.
Thank you to Professor Jaya and Professor Ashish for kindly inviting me to visit IIIT. It's been about 5 years since I moved to Bangalore, and it's 5 years too late that I'm coming to IIIT. It's a great place. I'm really happy to be here. Okay, so today's talk is going to be a very general, very high-level talk on cryptography, and I will sort of keep things at fairly basic level. So if you have any questions, feel absolutely free to interrupt me. And you know, depending on how we're doing on time and so on, towards the very end of the talk, I'll give you an overview of my own research. But for the first part of the talk, certainly will be fairly general. Okay. So when we think of cryptography, the first thing that typically comes to mind is you want to communicate securely. And when you think of cryptography, that's sort of the classic use case that we have in mind, that you want to communicate securely. And indeed, that's how the field of cryptography started. It was a military application where, for military purposes, they had to send messages securely. And the question was, how do you do it, right? So that's sort of where things all began. There are a lot of, just give you a, glimpse of a lot of papers that, sort of kick-started the area as such. So this, sort of famous paper by Claude Shannon talks about how you define the security of an encryption scheme. And it turns out that this is actually fairly non-trivial to define. And it also discusses something called, a limitation of information theoretic encryption. So what is information theoretic security? It's basically, in cryptography, it's like a constant, tug of war between the good guys and the bad guys, right? And the way you characterize any crypto system is by first pinning down who the bad guys are. By that we mean, what are the powers that the bad guys possess? There could be, different things. One, it could be the kinds of secrets that they share, the amount of randomness. Randomness is a very important cryptography resource in cryptography. The amount of computational power that the bad guys have. And in information theoretic cryptography, you're essentially assuming that the adversary has no bounds computationally. He can take forever to try and break your system, and you want to make sure that the adversary can still not break your crypto system. So it's a very strong definition. And he talks about certain limitations, and that sort of motivates the need to look beyond information theoretic cryptography, and we will talk about computational cryptography that essentially bypasses these limitations. But to sort of segue into the computational world, we need to talk about work that went on in the area of theory of computation or complexity theory, right? And these are some of the key players who developed an understanding of this notion of NP completeness. And what does this mean? You're essentially trying to understand when you take a particular task, when you have a particular function to compute, you have to sort of develop a notion of how easy or hard it is to compute or evaluate that function, but it needs to be done in a manner which is not dependent on the machine. Because we all know that, you know, the machines have, you know, what our machines can compute today is far different from what they could compute even like 5-10 years ago, right? So processors are going to get more powerful. So when you talk about a notion of difficulty of computing a function or ease of computing a function, it cannot be tied to a particular machine type. So it needs to, you need to evolve a theory which is independent. And this is where theory of computation comes up. And specifically, we'll talk about two different classes. One is the class P. These are the class of problems with polynomial time algorithms for solving them. And then there's the class NP. This is the class of deficient problems, yes or no problems, where the yes instances have efficiently verifiable proofs. Okay, now all of this, I know that the audience is somewhat mixed and it might seem a bit too abstract. But if you want to think of a problem in NP, just open your paper and stare at the Sudoku puzzle. That's all, right? So what is a Sudoku puzzle? When someone solves it, you know that there are a set of very simple rules on how you fill the grids, number of ones, number of whatever. Things should not repeat. Each grid should have all the numbers from 1 to 9. It's all simple, right? So the minute someone gives you a filled-in Sudoku puzzle, you'll be able to check all the boxes and say, yes, it's correct. But if you try and solve the Sudoku puzzle. Now, you might wonder, even solving the puzzle isn't really hard, right? Because there are people, clearly it's published in the newspaper, so people are doing it every day, right? So it's a kind of thing which is easy to do on small instances. But if you keep increasing the instance size, you're essentially imposing more and more constraints, and that's when it becomes difficult to solve. So Sudoku is an example of a problem that's NP complete. We won't talk about NP completeness, it's not relevant as such, but essentially this is basically a class of problems where the minute you keep increasing the size of your input, you may or may not be able to solve it efficiently. And again, we don't know whether P is equal to NP, so I can't say that it is necessarily difficult to solve it efficiently. But what we do know at the very least is that if someone gives you a yes instance, they actually solve the Sudoku puzzle and give it to you, you will be able to verify it. And that's sort of all you need to know. Okay. So, yes, so there are a lot of different problems in, you know, graph theory like Hamiltonian cycle and so on, which are examples of NP-complete problems, even number theoretic assumptions like factoring, quadratic residuosity and so on and so forth, which are believed to be NP-hard. So let me just very briefly tell you about the factoring problem. Many of you might have already seen it. So you have two numbers, P and Q, which are large primes, and you use them to compute N, which is equal to P times Q. Now, the problem asks you to do the following. Given N, find P and Q. Now, clearly the person who has come up with N, the person who's taken P and taken Q and come up with N, he'll definitely be able to answer it. But if you're only given N, and again, clearly we know how to factor small numbers, you know, someone says 35, okay, 7 into 5, that's great. But if N is large, then, you know, we don't know of efficient ways of deriving P and Q, where P and Q are large primes, right? So this is a factoring problem, and it's one of the very fundamental problems in cryptography. We'll talk about it. Okay, so so far what I've spoken about had nothing to do with cryptography, right? So, but where does, you know, cryptography actually come into play? Number theory has really important applications to cryptography, so when did it all start off? So one of the most pioneering works in this field was that due to Merkel, Hellman, and Diffie when they introduced public key cryptography as such. Before we talk about PKC, public key cryptography, let's talk about cryptography in the military setting. So in the military setting, you typically had two parties, you know, the famous Alice and Bob, and they shared a key. And the goal was for Alice and Bob to communicate securely, right? So that setting is typically called symmetric key cryptography. So you have Alice and Bob with their shared key K, and Alice can use this key to encrypt messages across to Bob. So that adversary sitting on the channel, the adversary is typically called Eve. Eve sitting on the channel cannot really tell what this message is. Now, defining security more formally is a little bit of work, and I'll do it in the context of public key cryptography in a bit. But for now, let's just work with the intuitive definition that you don't really have too much information about this underlying message, or any information, if you will, about the underlying message than what you already know about. Okay, so that's the ciphertext, right? Now, this model of symmetric key cryptography is severely limited in terms of applicability, because quite often you're interacting, especially in today's world, you're interacting with parties with whom you have no keys shared. So for instance, if you're, you know, working online on with Amazon or something like that, you don't really have a relationship with Amazon, right? So Amazon is, you know, it's got its own public keys perhaps, but you don't really have a relationship with Amazon. So the assumption that you can actually share a key with every single person that you want to talk to securely, it's just not going to work. It's not scalable at all. And there comes in public key cryptography. So the sort of fundamental question they ask is it possible for us to just walk into a room and still facilitate secure communication with people in the room? So for instance, now I just stand here and I give you some information that I sort of hold, you know, I generated on my own, and it should allow all of you, if you want to send me private messages. And you should be able to shout it out publicly, right? You should be able to sit in that corner of the room and say something that nobody else will understand. Okay, it's great. Even what if I also can't understand? Clearly that should not be the case. So there has to be some asymmetry in the definition, right? So I want to be able to understand, but you're telling me the exact same thing that you're telling the whole room. So what is the dichotomy? The asymmetry comes from the fact that as a person who generates this public information that you can use for communicating, I also at the same time generate some secret information that's known only to me. Okay, so you can view one of the parties to be the encryptor, the other party to be the decryptor. In other words, the decryptor is the one who has the ability to parse this secret information that's being sent to them. So the decryptor is the one who will generate the keys. So he generates a secret key along with a public key, and he sends the public key to the encryptor. And now Alice just needs to use this public key to encrypt messages, and the decryptor on his end can decrypt it with the secret key to recover M. So, and that in a sense represents, the power of public key cryptography. And the beauty is that this public key doesn't depend on each person who's trying to encrypt messages. It's just fixed for Bob, and anybody who wants to send messages to Bob can just encrypt it with that public key. Right. So it was a really powerful notion, and not surprisingly, Diffie and Hellman won a Turing Award for it somewhat recently. In around 1978, Rives, Shamir, and Adelman proposed the RSA crypto system, and this will sort of bring us to the connections between cryptography and hardness assumptions, actually. Sort of high-level idea in terms of the connections between the two is the following. The idea is that you want to show that if your encryption scheme, you want to show that your encryption scheme is secure, which means it's a good public key encryption scheme. And as I said, we've not really talked about security, but essentially you want to prevent an adversary from looking at the public key and breaking into the crypto system and learning information that only Bob here is supposed to learn. Right? That's the fundamental goal. Now you know, thanks to number theory, that there are problems which are believed to be hard for the adversary to crack. So in particular, we're talking about protecting the crypto system from those guys who only see the public key but not the secret key, right? Which means that you want to say that if the adversary can somehow break into the encryption scheme, then he does something non-trivial in terms of figuring out escape. And in particular, what you could potentially say, and this is how reductions in cryptography typically work, if your encryption scheme can be broken by an algorithm, then can you use that same algorithm to actually find a polynomial time algorithm for some hard problem? Now, philosophically, this is actually very interesting, because when you, from a number theory point of view, or from the point of view of computational complexity, whenever you look at hard problems, right, you say, we don't know how to solve it, it's too bad, right? You think of it as a negative. But here, it's really fascinating that these guys like Rivesh Shamir and Adelman and so on and so forth, they decided to take that very hard problem and leverage it in a very positive way to get something very strong and get something, at that point, which was very surprising, right? So that is actually really cool. So in other words, what you say is the only way for anybody to break the crypto system that I've designed is to give a polynomial time algorithm for solving a hard problem. Now, let's go to the factoring example. So, in the factoring example, that P cubed, hard to find P cubed given N is equal to P cubed. So very loosely, if you want to think about it, you could think of P and Q as corresponding to the secret key and N, the product of two primes, as corresponding to the public key. Now, in reality, that's not how the RSA crypto system works. You do a little bit more work before you get to the actual public key and the secret key. But you can sort of intuitively think of it like this. And now suppose someone says, I actually have a way to break the crypto system. It would be great if you could say, okay, if you can break the crypto system, then I will use it. How I use it, that's left for the person who's proving it. I will use it to find P and Q given this N. So that's the concept, that's the idea. And because scientists, number theorists believe that finding P and Q is a hard problem, it is unlikely, therefore, that someone will actually be able to break the crypto system. Now, any crypto proof that you have, essentially, you can boil it down to a reduction of this sort in theoretical cryptography. Whenever someone says, it's secure, then you can typically come up with a proof of the sort if it is really secure. Another interesting thing, along with sort of public key cryptography, was this thing called mental poker, which apparently was like a really big deal then. Shamir, Rivers, and Adelman actually wrote a paper on something called mental poker. And they don't really formally define it, even though they claim to do it in the paper. They don't really formally define security per se. And, Richard Lipton says, okay, there's actually a bug with the approach. And so on and so forth. So Silvio Micali and Shafi Golvasa, who were actually then students at UC Berkeley taking a number theory class, they came to know about this paper. And they said, okay, mental poker sounds really interesting. And how can we do it? So how many of you have heard of the game poker? It's a card game. You don't need to know too much about it. But it's sort of fascinating that at that point, maybe it was the era or maybe it was the people, they were so free-spirited that studying something like mental poker, how to play poker securely, how to play poker on the internet, is actually a done thing. Whereas now we might shy away from, being so bold, but they didn't. And it paid, rich dividends, because it was when they were trying to study mental poker that they kept looking at it. So what happens in poker? At the end of it, without getting into too much details about the game and stuff like that, the rules and stuff, it's essentially a card game, right? So you have 52 cards, and it's a game where you don't want other people to know what cards you have. And yet, you sort of have to play it online, right? Which means you have to somehow send information about your cards to be able to play that game. And in doing so when you want to do that, that sort of brings you to the notion of encryption. Now, up until that point, when people thought of encryption, they I don't think they really associated encryption of messages which came from a very small space. So if you have a pack of cards, how many cards are there? 52. So your possibilities, you just have 52 possibilities, and someone could just brute force and actually figure out, looking at the ciphertext, they could brute force and figure out what card you have. And it's very important sort of in cryptography, I mean in poker, that you don't reveal not just your card. People shouldn't even know whether there's something called a high card and a low card. People shouldn't even know that, right? Now, this sort of brought the understanding to Shafi and Silvio that you need to hide every partial information about the card. It's not just the value. It's not whether I have the, you know, king of dice. People shouldn't even know that the card I have is a high card. So you have to hide every bit of partial information that you can about the card. And this led them to realize that for actually building a secure crypto system, you cannot do it deterministically. Because what does it mean to do something deterministically? Deterministic is where you don't have randomness, right? There is no randomness in the algorithm. It's a deterministic algorithm that's used to compute it. So every time you run it, you get the same output because, you know, it's just f of x. That's it. And that's when the realization came that for public key cryptography, you need it necessarily to be randomized. Now, in doing so, instead of figuring out, going deeper and deeper and figuring it out, they actually solved this, you know, problem of mental poker. And the paper was probabilistic encryption, how to play mental poker. And it was yet another paper that sort of won a Turing Award recently, as did the RSA guys. Okay, so two interesting things. The way RSA apparently came about was that Adelman was a number theorist amongst them. And Rivest and Shamir would, you know, they were all at MIT, and Rivest and Shamir would go and, propose solutions to Adelman, and Adelman would keep breaking them. And in the process of continuously figuring out, you know, encryption, you know, proposing encryption schemes and then seeing it broken, that's when they actually came up with the final RSA crypto system, which is, again, something that's really fascinating and cool. Okay, so now probabilistic encryption and how Silvio and Shafi defined it is, I think, one of the very integral ideas to cryptography as such. So I will actually spend a little bit of time talking about the definition that they came up with. So cryptography is a field where formalism is valued a lot. It's not just about coming up with constructions and saying, you know, I think it's secure. It's about formalizing it and proving that it's secure, and that's foundation was sort of laid by these two people here. So that brings me to semantic security. It's the notion of security that they came up with. Okay, the variant I'm going to present here is not exactly the same as what it was in the paper. It's equivalent, but this is just something that's easier to understand, and it's also standard. Let's say I want to talk about security of an encryption scheme. I could say I don't want the adversary Eve to guess the message given C. As I told you in the example of, you know, cards, this is really not a very good definition, right? Because even though the adversary does not learn enough to guess the message as such, the adversary could potentially learn something really critical, some critical information that's useful for him, and he could learn something about him. In the case of poker, it's maybe the high card or the suit or something like that, right? So you don't want him to learn anything. So how do you formalize this notion that the adversary cannot learn anything about the message given the ciphertext? So the way it works is like this. You tell the adversary, you pick, I'm going to give you the public key. You look at my public key, so you're as powerful as you can hope to be. And looking at my public key, you come up with two of your favorite messages, the messages that you want to encrypt. And as the challenger, Alice is going to pick one of the messages at random and sends that ciphertext across. And now the adversary's goal is to guess which message was encrypted. Was it M0 or was it M1? And the hope is that if the crypto system is secure, the hope is that it will not, the adversary will not be able to guess it with a probability greater than half. Can you hope to get less than that? No, right? Because it's only one bit. So you can, even if you make a random guess, the adversary is going to succeed with a probability half. So this is sort of the definition. And what is interesting about the definition is, if you see, you are not requiring anything about the message that you're starting with. The message could just be zero or one. It could be one single bit. And I think this was sort of the first time when, you know, people, when, you know, cryptographers actually defined it in such a powerful manner where they said, if you have one bit encryption, that's actually enough, because it turns out that you can actually compose it to encrypt arbitrary length messages, right? So all you have to do is to be able to encrypt one single bit, and, you know, that sort of suffices. So now, with all this work on encryption and so on just went on, people knew how to communicate securely. And then they asked, okay, so now we know how to communicate securely, are we done? But the goal, at least in today's world, is really far from secure communication. Secure communication, it in fact is secure computation, right? You want to compute on shared data, and mutually untrusting parties want to compute on shared data. So to sort of formalize, and we'll talk a little bit more about this in just a little bit, but you want parties who don't have any reason to trust each other to be able to run tasks on their inputs, right? So I could have some inputs, somebody else across the room could have some inputs, and maybe I've never met that person before, and we still should be able to compute some joint functions of our shared inputs. So that's sort of the goal that we're going towards. And to talk about this, I will tell you a little bit about zero knowledge proofs, and then I'll get to secure computation. Let's talk about something called interactive proofs first. This is work by Babai, Morin, Goldwasser, Mikali, and Rakoff. So suppose you want to prove something. Our typical notion of a proof, seen it in school, we've written proofs in mathematics, is something that can be written on a piece of paper and you send it to your teacher, and your teacher is actually able to verify it, right? So it's mathematically, it's very well understood what a proof actually means. You start off with some premise, you have a set of axioms, you're able to use the derivations, and then finally go to the statement that you want to prove, and then it's a proof, right? So it's very clear. Now, does that really have to be the only kind of proof? And in particular, if you don't have this requirement that a proof has to be written down, can you actually prove something more? Okay, so an example of, someone trying to prove something is that someone claims that P is not equal to NP, then that person will have to write down a proof, and the rest of the, you know, community will sit and try and verify it, right? And this is true for almost everything. But now, suppose I want to prove something really bizarre. Let's say that I want to prove that color exists to a colorblind person. What is a colorblind person? Someone who, you know, typically I think it's the red-green colorblindness, where both the colors appear the same to a particular person. And it's very common, right? And now I want to prove that color exists to a colorblind person. Now this seems really bizarre. I cannot actually write down a proof, right? How can I write down a proof? It does not make any sense. But can I give a proof for this? Now, it turns out that a statement like this, the minute you add interaction, you will be able to prove it. Okay? So, let's see how it works. Now, I have a one-year-old daughter, which means I sometimes steal her toys. So, I have red, and I have green, and I have red. Now, I want to convince people that these are actually two different colors. So, let's try and come up with a protocol together. And the key point is that this is, we're allowing for interaction. So I want to use interaction to somehow prove that these two are actually different, even though to a person who's looking at it, they look exactly, for a colorblind person who's looking at it, they look exactly identical. There is no, it doesn't look different at all. So how might one do that? I'm not, obviously not going to let Ashish and Vivek answer the question. Okay, so basically we're in a setting where these two objects appear identical to someone, and if you want that person to be able to tell apart, you know, if you want to convince the person that you can actually tell it apart because it's got some attribute that you're able to perceive that they're not able to perceive, it's likely that you want to, you know, sort of map it out to something that they can actually perceive, right? So for hypothetical reasons, let me just, I don't know if the marker will work on this, but let me just write a 0 on this and a 1 on this, right? So I've written a 0 on this and a 1 on this. So clearly a person who is looking at the front side will be able to tell whether it's a 0 or a 1, okay? But now, how do I use this information? I've mapped it to two things that the person I'm trying to prove it to can actually tell apart. So that's great. How do I use this information? Yes. So accepting information just because there are more people saying it is actually a very bad idea in life and in cryptography. So we don't want to do that. And you really want to have a solid reason to believe that it's actually true. It's not just so much that people have said it. Yes.
You can give those two comments to the blind person and colorblind person. And you can suggest which color. You can tell this is one and this is, based on the color. But he should accept it because
that's it. Okay, that's a great idea. That's actually the protocol. So you're almost there. I'll just sort of flash it out and explain. Good. Okay. Sorry, your name, please.
Rohit.
Okay, good. So Rohit's suggestion was that as a person who can tell apart the two colors, I have to guess which number is written on it. Because the colorblind person can still see that, oh, you know what, this says 0 and that says 1. So that's great. So as a person who can tell the two colors apart, I should actually guess the number and, therefore convince the person who's colorblind that I am indeed able to tell the colors, right? So let's just be a little bit more formal and write it out. So we agree that this is the mapping. And now these toys can be given to the verifier who can actually look at the numbers. And we say, go ahead and swap it. Swap it and show me one of them. And I need to guess what number is visible to you, right? So we've swapped it and what we have is red. And therefore we know that it's mapped to a 1. And now the prover just has to guess the number, say that, okay, you have the number 1 on your screen, and the verifier will actually be able to verify it because you can just see it and know that it's 1 that's written on it, right? Okay, so you do this, so the protocol is now clear. You do this once, what is the probability that a prover will be able to, guess it? Even though there's no two different colors, it's all the same, what is the probability that the prover will be able to guess it? 1/2. Okay, so 1/2 is not very convincing, right? I said by the end of it, we need to be really convinced that the prover wasn't cheating us. Okay, so the question is, how paranoid do you want to be? Let's do it another time. You do it another time. Again, the same thing, right? Swap it and pick something at random, right? What are the odds that the prover will get it right? Twice in a row? 1/4? Paranoia strikes? 1/8? So on and so forth. You do it. T times, what is the probability? 1/2, right? So do it enough number of times, exponentially low probability that the prover has actually cheated you and you've not caught him. So that's a very low probability. So you know that it must be a true statement. You know that he really has a witness for that statement. Now, not surprisingly, this class of interactive proofs is actually fairly powerful and it's equivalent to P space, which is believed to be larger than NP, but let's not go into that. So now the question is, it's great to have interactive proofs, and it seems like with interactive proofs, we can prove something much more powerful than what you can prove with just NP, right? With NP, you have a statement, you have a witness, and someone just gives it across, sends the witness across, and then you verify whether the relation is true or not. So that's great. Now, but a question to ask is, can you have a proof which doesn't reveal anything other than the validity of the statement you're trying to prove, right? So at the end of the protocol, you want, as a verifier, to know that the statement is true. And even if the verifier is potentially sneaky and trying to learn extra information, you want to make sure that the verifier cannot actually learn that information. And all he learns is whether the statement is true or false. That's it, right? And this brings us to yet another powerful, beautiful primitive in cryptography called zero-knowledge proofs. So let me give you an example. So we have this magician who has a wand, and he says, you know, I have a really powerful wand, and I just swing it, and I can use it to count the number of leaves on a tree. Now, again, this is really bizarre. So how, and, you know, think of these as being really large trees, right? Not the kinds we see in Bangalore these days. And you have a king that says, okay, this is actually cool, but how do I know that you are, how do I know that you're actually being truthful, that you can actually count this, right? So given what we've seen and sort of my click, can someone come up with a protocol for this? Okay, so one thing is that, you know, the king can actually count the number of leaves on the tree on his own, but that sort of defeats the purpose because we're viewing this as a powerful task that not everybody can do. That's why he's a magician, right? Otherwise, there's no point. Yes? Yes. Yes. Okay. So, sorry, what's your name?
Leela.
Sorry?
Leela.
Leela. Okay, great. That's actually a great suggestion. It's not quite there, and I will tell you why it's not quite there, but it's a great suggestion. So the suggestion, just to repeat, is the following. You can restrict your domain to a small part of the tree and just have the magician count that part of the tree, and because it's a small part, the king can count it himself, and so on and so forth. That's correct, except that maybe the, you know, magician's wand only works on small trees. Maybe it doesn't work on large trees, right? In which case he can cheat. So you don't have a guarantee that he can count 5 million leaves. Maybe he can count 5,000. So Manpreet has a suggestion where we make a change to the tree and the, you know, magician sort of has to guess the change. And what is the change? You pluck a few leaves and the magician has to pluck how many leaves. That's also almost there, but not quite there, and I'll tell you why. Again, if it's a small number of leaves that you're plucking, then I can just guess, right? But you're almost there, and I'll just show you the protocol. So the king can essentially say, count the number of leaves in this particular tree, right? So draw a tree with a million whatever leaves, send it across any arbitrary tree, and ask the magician to count. And now the magician says, okay, it's some number. We have no idea, no reason to believe that it's true. We have no way of verifying it, and that's okay. And then we say the following. At random, as the king, at random, I'll either pluck one leaf or I'll leave the tree as it is. Okay? So now there are only two options, and the adversary has to guess which of the two is the case, right? So he does some magic and he says, you know, the answer is either 53870 or 53871, one of the three two possibilities. And the king just needs to see if it's correct or not. Okay, if you do it once, what is the probability that half, right? So you do this enough number of times, you will actually have a pretty good idea that, you know, the magician can really count the number of leaves in the tree. So we know that the prover is not lying with a high probability. Good. Okay. And what does this have to do with zero knowledge? And before we actually get to zero knowledge, let me sort of formally write out the properties you want from a proof, you know, proof system as such, right? So in a zero-knowledge proof system, you want something called correctness, which essentially, you know, typically in all of these protocols, correctness just says if everyone is behaving the way they are, then you should be able to prove a theorem, so on and so forth, yes?
You would have told that statement that we said before, and then the tool is cheating the magician. Then
you
would have guessed at one and a half.
So the verifier is trying to learn, no, he's trying to learn information, yes, but he's, you know, first, let's, you know, just for simplicity, think of the honest verifier situation, right? In the honest verifier situation, the verifier is really just trying to learn whether it's a true statement or a false statement. So he cannot have any reason to lie, because just by plucking two leaves, he's not really going to, you know, the prover is going to say, you're messing with me, I'm not even going to talk to you. Now, what happens if the verifier is not honest? In this particular case, typically when you're looking at the behavior of a prover and a verifier, you assume that they're following the protocol, in the sense that if the verifier actually plucks two leaves, then the prover is well within his right to say, I'm going to stop. Right? So you can think of it that way. On the other hand, so we do want to talk about soundness. And soundness sort of captures security in the sense that you want to make sure that a prover cannot cheat the verifier and get it to accept a false statement. So that's where the whole repetition comes into play. So no, no, please go ahead.
Yeah.
Yes.
Suppose first time testing plus one lift, then Malaysian is supposed to know the result, true or false?
He's supposed to guess whether it was plucked or not.
Suppose he tells.
I'm saying how he guesses is really the magician's problem. If he really is a magician that can count the number of leaves, then he will know for sure whether it was plucked or not, right? And we're trying to ascertain the magician's power. So how the magician is the all-powerful prover. How he proves it is not our problem.
No, it's not our problem.
My
problem is that the magician knows every step. Suppose n number of times I want to verify. So when n equal to 1, am I supposed to tell him that you are right?
You're supposed, every time you play it, you're supposed to guess it correctly. If he doesn't guess it, if the magician's guess is wrong even once, then the prover will reject. Because that's when the 1 over 2 to the L probability or whatever, right, the number of repetitions.
First time he fails, the game is over.
The game is over. The prover is no longer convinced. I'm sorry, the verifier is no longer convinced, and they will say, no, you're cheating. So that's when the success probability actually comes into play. Right? And then there is zero knowledge. I'm not going to define it formally because it's actually pretty challenging to define it. So please take Ashish's class if you want to know more about it. But essentially in zero knowledge, what you want to say is that looking at the transcript, you can't really get any additional information about the, you know, secret inputs that only the prover sort of has, right? Sort of very intuitively, I can always draw a tree. I can always show, I draw, you know, these many lines, I draw a tree, and then I pluck one leaf, and then I send back a tree, so this is tree prime, and then I can, you know, write some number, 5,358, and then I pluck, and then I write 5,357, so on and so forth. And in essence, I can generate the whole transcript on my own without even knowing such an algorithm, right? And it's a bit counterintuitive, but that is sort of what zero knowledge captures. It's basically, saying that you can write out whatever transcript you've seen on your own. You could have generated the whole transcript on your own, which means that you didn't learn anything about the underlying witness in the case of an NP statement, for example. Okay, but as I said, I'm not going to talk too much about zero knowledge. But I do want to state that defining zero knowledge requires an understanding of this thing called, you know, simulation paradigm, which again is sort of a breakthrough in cryptography. It's really cool to understand it. But in essence, in a zero knowledge proof, the verifier should not learn anything about the algorithm other than the fact that it is. Now you may ask, what use is a zero knowledge proof in cryptography? These days, there's so much talk about blockchains that people may not ask this question, but these slides are old, so please forgive me. But let me give you a very traditional application. So let's say that you want to log into some server, and you have a password. So you're the user, you have a password, and there's a server out there. So typically, if you want to prove your identity to the server, what would you do? You would take your password, hash it, and give it to the server. And the server would just store the hash. And now to sign in, traditionally, what would you do? You'd have just sent your password across. And you know, the server would have said, okay, you know what, this password maps to this hash function, so you're all set, you can go on. But now with a zero-knowledge proof, you can do something better. You can essentially say, I can run a zero-knowledge protocol to prove that I know the value of the password. So in essence, what is the server convinced about? The server is convinced that you know the password, and therefore you're the legitimate user. At the same time, because it's zero-knowledge, the server doesn't learn anything else. He doesn't really learn anything about your password. So it's all good. So you essentially don't have to send the password to the server ever. But yeah, zero-knowledge has a lot of applications, again, in blockchains and stuff. So we spoke about zero-knowledge proofs. A very quick run-through of the other things on this slide. So in secure computation, again, Ashish will give better talks on this because he's the expert. You have two parties, Alice and Bob, and the goal is to find out who is richer without, it's like a use case example, find out who is richer without, telling people how much you actually possess. And you can do this great using secure computation, and it turns out that it's not just the greater than function or whatever it is. You can compute any arbitrary function you want in a secure manner, and it has amazing applications. You could have two hospitals that have patient records, and now you can actually run joint statistics on your databases without revealing patient information. So let's say you have a lung cancer institute, and then you have an institute which is studying diabetes, and you want to see if there's any connection between these two. Obviously, you don't want these two hospitals to exchange the patient records, and you don't want to run an intersection on that. But you can still get this information on whether there is a correlation. So you're just doing the study of correlation under the hood in some sense. Without sharing those records, you can actually still find out interesting correlation. So especially given how many people are interested in ML, right? So I know a lot of students are really taking to ML these days. This, secure ML is really the way to go. So you definitely want to take crypto courses and want to get an understanding, because without security, you're not really going to go ahead too much, right? So that's really critical. So you have multiple parties who want to compute functions on their private inputs without revealing much to each other. And the typical things that you want to study is, what is the overhead when it comes to running such a protocol? And because in terms of feasibility, there's a lot of great work in cryptography where the action is happening right now is an understanding of what are the communication costs, what are the computation costs, and what are the security guarantees. From a practical point of view, how efficient is it? And especially in a scenario, especially in today's world where there is so much ML going on, this is really what people are concerned about, right? Because it would be really cool for, in terms of the use cases that you can actually provide. And you can say, you can work, you can listen to music on YouTube, and we are going to try and figure out what sort of music you like so that we can send you good recommendations. At the same time, we're not going to be sneaky, we're not going to snoop, because we're using cryptography, so your information is still safe. Those kinds of things. So plenty of use cases. It's quite fascinating. Then there's homomorphic encryption. In a nutshell, when you have a standard public key encryption scheme, you have a public key, you have a secret key, and they're just sending messages across. The decryptor learns M using C. And with a homomorphic encryption, on the other hand, you want to be able to compute functions of the message, just looking at the ciphertext. So in particular, you want to be able to compute on M even without knowing the secret key. You want to be able to apply arbitrary operations, public operations, to compute encryption of F of M for any F. Where does this have an application? Think of a scenario where you are sort of running computation on a cloud that you don't necessarily trust, then you can actually just put your data in an encrypted manner on the cloud that you don't trust. And then under the hood, using just the evaluation key, you can actually compute encryption of F of M. And then when someone gives you back the ciphertext, you just have to decrypt and learn F of M. So it's really useful. And a lot of fascinating work has gone on in this as well. For instance, there are very efficient algorithms for additively homomorphic encryption, where you have two ciphertexts which encrypt, and you want to be able to compute the sum of those messages underlying those ciphertexts. Likewise, you could have multiplication. Turns out RSA is a multiplicative homomorphic encryption scheme. And most recently, there was a big breakthrough where in 2009, where Craig Gentry came up with a fully homomorphic encryption scheme, which means you can also, you can add and multiply. So this is really powerful, and it's one of those cool results out there. But on the flip side, while it's more expressive, it's also more inefficient, not surprisingly, right? It's really powerful and therefore also inefficient. Because we don't have too much time, I won't talk to you about program obfuscation. Maybe I'll just state it and then leave it. So in program obfuscation, what do you do? It's basically a very powerful tool from the point of view of software engineering, because you don't, software companies don't want people to know their code, right? So now if you had a way to obfuscate the code, that would be great, because I can just put the code in an obfuscated manner and nobody will be able to tell what it actually does, right? So that's what is program obfuscation. Again, cryptography is really useful in the setting to answer questions on what you can potentially do in obfuscation, right? Let me just give you a quick intro of the research that we do in my research group. So we work on two problems. So far, we've been focusing on two problems. One is non-malleable codes and the other is privacy amplification. Okay, so in this talk, I tried to tell you, a lot about how cool cryptography is, right? And it is very cool. You can have encryption schemes, you can have digital signatures, authentication, so on and so forth. It's really fascinating. It's all great. But everything I told you had a huge asterisk, and I said conditions apply. And what is the condition? For security to hold, for it to actually be a secure crypto system, you have got to store your secret key in a safety vault like this that nobody can access. Right? And there are many reasons in practice why this is a terrible assumption to make. And in particular, there are these things called related key attacks. And again, the person to talk to here on this front is Vivek, because he's the expert on side channel attacks. So there are these things called related key attacks where, let me actually go ahead and give you the example. So let's say you have a chip that does, digital signatures, right? So someone gives you a message and it gives you back a signed message. It takes the message and it signs it and gives it back to you. Now the security holds only so long as the key is unaltered. Nobody has modified it, nobody has touched it, it's all good, right? The minute somebody takes the key and changes it to say 2K, then if he observes, signatures with respect to this message 2K, then he can easily come up with a mechanism to leak the faulty signature on K itself. And in a sense, he breaks the security of the crypto system completely. There is no guarantee at all. Okay, so we want to build what is called tamper-resilient cryptography, cryptography that's secure even in spite of these very powerful attacks. The way we do it is the following. We say, let's try and make sure that the key that's tampered, even if someone tries to tamper it, always tampers it to something independent. He cannot take K and turn it into 2K. If he is tampering it, maybe he'll go to the string of all zeros, which is not going to give any information anyway, right? And this is where non-malleable codes come into play. And it turns out, and I, sort of making a leap of faith, you should just make a leap of faith along with me here. It's not clear why this is useful, but it turns out that having this guarantee that the adversary can only tamper it, if at all, to something independent actually suffices. You'll be able to protect your crypto system because all of the information that the adversary learns, because it's independent of the key, you needn't have even had access to the key. You could have generated it on your own. It's completely independent, right? So it can't possibly give you more information. The original crypto system still remains secure. Okay, so there are ways of defining a non-malleable code, which gives you this guarantee, which I'm not going to go into. One of the key parameters when you're building a non-malleable code is to get good rate non-malleable codes. The higher the rate, it means the lesser the redundancy. That's a good thing. There's also something called tampering function family, which I'm not going to get into. I'll be happy to talk about offline. And there's been a lot of works in, improving the rate of non-malleable codes for strong enough tampering families. And with my student Shruti and Bhavana, we end up making some progress on this problem for the four split state function. Okay, so the biggest open problem in the field of non-malleable codes is something called building a half-rate non-malleable code for two states. I haven't gone into the details of what they are, but this is sort of the biggest open problem. And we've made progress towards it by building, exactly that, but for random messages. So we get a variant of non-malleable codes where the message distribution is uniform. And we're actually able to use that to also get some additional progress on standard non-malleable codes, where we're not making any assumption on the underlying message. The other big area that we've been working on is privacy amplification. In this, you have two parties, Alice and Bob, who are now trying to play against an unbounded adversary. Alice and Bob both share some weak key, so it's not completely uniform. Typically, when you talk about RSA and stuff, you need the secret keys to be completely uniform. You don't make those assumptions. They have some weak keys, and the goal is to communicate back and forth and agree on a completely uniform key. And here you desire something called constant round complexity and linear entropy loss, and we show how to build protocols for this, and we give some candidate constructions to get optimal entropy loss protocols using non-malleable codes. Okay, last 2 minutes. So Bangalore has actually been a fantastic area for cryptography. I've been here for 5 years and it's been absolutely fantastic. So what's nice about it, there's two cryptographers sitting in IIIT Bangalore, and that's great. There's at least 4 cryptographers sitting in North Bangalore and at IISc. And if you go from IIIT Bangalore all the way to IISc and you get stuck in traffic, you will land up in Microsoft Research, which also has a whole bunch of cryptographers. So it's been an absolutely fantastic place to be, and I specifically encourage the students in the audience to really get mileage out of it. There are a lot of talks, and Silvio Micali was one of our recent visitors, and he even met our students and stuff, and they absolutely loved his presentation. So do make use of the resources that you have in Bangalore. It's a really nice place to be for cryptography. We also, have in the past conducted a lot of schools, workshops, reading groups and so on. So we sort of encourage you to sort of be a part of this community. All right. So to conclude, cryptography is truly a fascinating field. A lot of potential for collaborations across the board, especially now there's blockchain, ML, a lot of applications for cryptography. So you really have a lot to look forward to in this field. Thank you.